Today I'll go through the requirements for what I'm tentatively calling the regressive field rifle or the regressive flexible rifle, the RFR. If you guys come up with a better name, please put it down in the comments below and upvote each other's comments. Let's see what comes out on top here. I'll take the next week or two and see what you guys come up with, and we'll name the rifle that. Now I do reserve the right to veto, so if you come up with Bodie McBoatface or Hitler Did Nothing Wrong, then I'm not going to name the rifle that. But yeah, come up here and let's see what I have in mind for this rifle. This is not a show rifle, this is a field rifle. It may come out ugly, as long as it functions, I do not care. And every piece on this is going to be part of this puzzle. It's all going to meet some very specific need. I don't want anything that's there for looks, I want everything to just function out in the field. And remember that field work is going to involve multiple animals. We're talking about a typical Oklahoma ranch, which is going to have animals in all different shapes and sizes, different flavors, different distances. And we're gonna have to have a rifle that can deal with all of them. That's talking about dangerous animals that are really close up, like hogs, to very difficult animals to hit, like prairie dogs at some of the longer distances. We may have coyotes that move around a whole lot, and I want a rifle that can address all of those. So the very first thing I want to start out with, especially because we are dealing with a high danger factor with hogs, I want this to be a semi-automatic platform, and the AR-15 is perfect. It's already set up for 6mm arc, or should I say 6mm arc is already set up for it. And that is our cartridge choice. Remember that video? This is one that's going to have a lot more heat than 223. It's going to have better exterior ballistics. It's going to have better everything. It's going to be an excellent choice for this, and overall the rifle should be very lightweight. Not only do I want this rifle to be lightweight, easy to carry around, easy to get up to the shoulder and point, I want this to have a proper balance, and we're going to see what we can do to achieve that. A lot of these AR-15s end up pretty muzzle heavy, and I want to push it a little further back so it's easier to hold for longer periods of time and just easier to track through game. All right, so let's start with the core. We have the AR-15 platform, and then really the core within that is going to be the barrel and bolt combo. I want these to work together really well, and when it comes to that barrel, I don't want something that's super duper heavy. I don't want a varmint style barrel or a bull barrel. I want something that's going to be field practical, and I want its length to be somewhere between 16 and 18 inches. Either one of those is going to work out really well. We'll talk about the exact parts that I picked in an upcoming video. I think it's two from now. We're actually going to put this all together and show what it's like and why I chose different parts, but also get into some of the options you might have to maybe meet your needs a little bit better or to meet your budget better. But yeah, I'm looking for something in the 16 to 18 inch range. Doesn't matter if it's chrome moly, if it's stainless. Stainless would be nice because I will be getting this wet. It's going to be a rifle that's going to live in the rain and actual elements. This is something that's gonna get dirty, it's gonna get messy. And so if I can find stainless, that'd be awfully nice. 16 to 18 inches, that is not an arbitrary number. This is going to have a couple of positive effects. First off, it's going to make this a little bit easier to move around, a little easier to swing. It's not going to knock against the ground. It's not going to knock against tree branches so easily. It's just going to be easier to carry out in the field. Also, it's going to move the weight a little bit farther backward so that we don't end up with a really muzzle-heavy rifle. Another one to think about is the efficiency of the cartridge and where its optimal length is. Depending on the ammo, I've already run these tests, 18 inches is just about perfect, and this is going to vary with different bullet weights. As we get into some of the lighter ones, it might be different. With some of the heavier ones, really 18 inches is just about right. Yes, even if you had a 32-inch barrel, that bullet would continue to accelerate and it would be faster than it would through an 18-inch barrel, but you start to get into kind of an asymptote effect where, yes, it's going to continue to accelerate, but not at the rate that it was before. So we can still get very good muzzle velocity out of an 18-inch barrel, and then it starts to just kind of decline little by little as we get into longer barrels. Whatever manufacturer I end up going with on this barrel, I'm going to want a bolt that matches it, just because I don't want to have to mess with headspace or anything. I want something that's built to work with it. I'd like an adjustable gas block. So this is one that I can switch out in the field based on my ammunition if possible, or if necessary, because I may actually develop subsonics for 6mm arc. I haven't seen these yet, but I've developed subsonics for a variety of cartridges so far. I've done 6.5 Creedmoor, 223, 308, and they can be effective in certain situations, so I may come up with that, and maybe a gas block will make it so that I can, or an adjustable gas block will make it so that I can cycle this bolt, even using something that's low power like that. Wrapping around that barrel, I would like an M-Lock handguard that is extremely lightweight. Like I mentioned, we can get really muzzle heavy on one of these carbines, and I want to make sure that I don't end up that way, so I want something that's very light. Out on this end, I want a muzzle brake, something that's going to tame the recoil a little bit, and I already have this picked out. I use a YHM Phantom suppressor, and it comes with these different devices. You can have either a flash hider or a brake, and I bought a whole bunch of brakes for my rifle, so we will have that on the end. If I decide to shoot without a suppressor, it'll still mitigate the recoil and I can get on target a lot more quickly. And then I have the can. And remember that the can will mess up the balance quite a bit. So I'll see how this actually functions once I get the rifle all put together. How bad is it going to be? How difficult will it be to hold this in position for longer periods of time? Yeah, we'll find out. A fair bit of the time when I'm using the suppressor, I'll probably be using a bipod as well. And I want something that I can quickly attach and detach from the handguard here so that I can fix some of the weight. I don't want to be lugging around a couple extra pounds here on the end of the rifle. That's pretty awful. Moving back, since we're dealing with, again, dangerous animals that may be close up, like hogs, or I want to be able to very quickly get back on target if I miss a longer shot, I want the biggest magazines that I can find for 6mm arc. We're dealing with dangerous animals in the case of hogs, and they may be very close up, so I want to be able to put as much heat on those animals as I possibly can. And remember that in some cases, we're going to be dealing with a whole bunch of animals at once. I don't want to do mag changes unless I absolutely have to, and so it'd be nice to get the biggest mags available. Moving backward, I want a good trigger. I am a huge trigger snob. I want something that's either a very crisp two-stage, I love those, or a crisp single stage. I don't want something that's smooth. I don't want something that is more like military style. I want something that's going to function more like a race trigger. Not quite. I don't want quite a race trigger. Those can be a little bit finicky. And I don't want something that's extremely lightweight, because remember that I may be wearing gloves, but I want something that's going to have a very, very crisp break to it, and probably somewhere in the 3.5 to 6 pound region. Anything in there should be just fine. I like 4.5, I like 3.5. As far as the grip goes, I'm looking for something that's a bit more vertical. This is something that's going to be more comfortable, especially in the prone, because I'm going to fire this rifle from all kinds of different positions, and a laid-back grip is going to kind of kink up the wrist. The stock, I want this to have some heft to it. I want this to have some weight. I want this to be more than your typical six-position carbine stock that everybody has. I have some of those on some of my other rifles, and they're fine. It keeps the weight down when you're moving around, but when it comes time to take the shot, I want something that's going to pitch the weight a little further back, keep the balance behind my front hand very neatly. I want the balance to be somewhere right around here, around the front of the action, and the further I can push it back, the better. I would also like this stock to conform to me better than the typical carbine stock, so I'd like to have an adjustable cheek piece, and I'd like to have an adjustable butt, not only for the length of pull, but also I want it to be able to cant and maybe do some other tricks. Like maybe I can change the height on it, and this will be able to match up with my individual shooting positions a whole lot better. For field carriage, I want a sling, and I'm looking at something that has some of these pop sockets. If you guys have a preferred one, please put it in the comments below. I've used the Magpul, the one that is a two position or one position. I like those quite a bit, and I intend to put some of those pop sockets. There's gonna be one on the stock back here. I think it's right about in that position. And then I can put one anywhere out here on the forearm. But yeah, you guys let me know what works for you, and maybe I can try out something that you've really liked. For now, I'll leave alone the sighting system. I want to talk about this in its own video because this is extremely important to me. It's nice to have a good rifle, but this is key to getting on target with the practical animals that I'll be dealing with and the practical distances that I have. So I have a very specific scope in mind. And then when it comes to iron sights, I'm still debating whether I'm going to put them on here or not. I've talked before about how I love to have a pair of backup iron sights, and how really in a lot of cases I consider them the primary sights for my rifle. But I think in this case, I'm going to leave them off just for weight's sake. We'll see. I have a pair in mind that could work out really, really well for this rifle. This will seem foreign to you longtime social regressive watchers, but I'm not actually concerned too much about the accuracy of this rifle. I want this to be field practical. If it turns out groups that are below one MOA, then I will be over the moon, I'll be perfectly happy, and the parts that I've chosen may end up shooting that well. We'll see. And especially as we get into hand loading, we may have really tight groups. But that's not the most important thing. I want this to be something that's going to be reliable, functional. I want it to be lightweight and easy to get on target, and then I want to be able to deal with those practical targets at practical distances. I'm not trying to cut a piece of paper in half at 1,000 yards. I'm trying to hit a prairie dog within 300. I'm trying to hit a hog within 300 yards. I'm trying to hit a deer within maybe 200 yards, a coyote out to 600. Those are the sorts of things that I want this rifle to be able to do, and if I'm within, you know, one MOA, one and a half, that's gonna be fine. Big thanks to patrons of the Destructive Arts for making this series possible. We're gonna take this all the way from concept to field use, and we'll see how this works. I'll see you in the next video.
Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe. Even if you didn't like this particular content, go ahead and subscribe. There's probably something coming that's more up your alley. Check out this playlist right here. This is going to have videos in a similar vein to what you just watched. These two videos we cherry-picked for you. And finally, The Social Regressive is on Patreon. So, you can become a patron of the Destructive Arts and earn some goodies while helping us to provide high-quality videos just by kicking us a few bucks a month. Thanks a bunch for your patronage.